Local stories, local people. We're taking you inside Western Mass News. It's the Even Better Western Mass podcast with Dave Madsen.
Welcome to this week's edition of the Even Better Western Mass podcast. Hope you're doing well. My guest this week is Meghan Rothschild. Meghan is the founder of Chikmedia, a Western Mass marketing and public relations firm. Her emphasis is on organizations run by women and women business owners. Chikmedia offers strategic marketing and public relations. We also talk with Meghan about her dealing with cancer and her work as a spokesperson for Impact Melanoma. Here's my conversation with Meghan Rothschild.
I mean, we've heard from you and we've seen you, and tell folks a little bit about Meghan Rothschild.
Yeah, so I currently own and operate a full-service marketing and public relations firm, Chikmedia. We are focused primarily on female entrepreneurs, but of course I always do a little asterisk and say we have plenty of male clients because everyone always asks. So we work with a variety of different businesses, and I'm loving it. I spent years working in a variety of different sectors. I was in nonprofit for many years at the Food Bank of Western Mass and also Impact Melanoma. I worked at Six Flags New England. That was really my first job, my first real job out of college. I was the advertising and promotions manager there. And so I've had sort of a lot of jobs and sort of a short period of time professionally. But I think I've really found sort of where I need to be right now with owning my own business, although entrepreneurship is no joke. It's quite the roller coaster. Personally, I'm from Western Mass. I went to college in Rhode Island, so I lived in Rhode Island for a few years, but I've always been in Massachusetts, and fur mom of four, two cats, two dogs, and with my husband, and cancer survivor as well. So a lot of stuff going on.
There is. We're going to talk more about that later, but let's talk about your decision to start up Chikmedia. What was your motivation, your catalyst for doing that?
Yeah. So, I mean, I'll be honest with you. I, as a woman, a young woman starting out in her professional career, I faced a lot of unfortunate situations, a lot of harassment in the workplace, both by men and women. And I finally was at one of my final jobs. I was in a really, I'd say, I don't want to say high profile, but I was high up there considering my age. You know, I was late 20s and I was a director, and really loved the job, but was getting a lot of feedback about the way that I looked and the way that I was dressing. And there was a lot of really awful negative comments made about me, both by people who worked there and people who didn't, volunteers and whatnot. And so I decided to start a company that was going to empower women and was going to make women support one another. That was really the goal. I wanted to end what I had gone through. Like, I didn't want any other woman to have to deal with that. So I said, I'm going to start a company that focuses primarily on empowering women business owners. And it was a combination of that and also constantly being asked to write press releases or help with social media or look at websites. And I finally said, okay, there might be a need here. Like, I probably should maybe become a consultant and start charging for that. And it sort of evolved into starting and building a company now that its primary focus is on women.
Let's talk about, you know, women in the workplace in this day and age. And, you know, as you mentioned, what you experienced that, and as a man, we probably don't think about it that much, but it's still a serious problem in 2020.
Yeah, and that's what's really frustrating, because it's funny you say that, Dave, because my mother, growing up, say that to me. Say to her, Mom, it's not still a problem. Like, there is no inequality in the workplace. Like, Mom, you're thinking of, you know, your times at in work. And she'd say, no, Meghan, it still exists, because she too dealt with some issues being in security, which was a prominently male career at the time. She dealt with a lot of issues. And I would say to her, Mom, I don't think that's common. And then when I got out into the workforce, I realized right away that it was still a thing. And it's really a cultural thing. Like, I remember my first big event at my first job, and I wore a black suit dress down to the knee, t-shirt, very well put together. Like, I thought it was like my first big girl job outfit. And I had on boots, and that had a tiny little kitten heel. And I remember everyone telling me that I was wearing hooker boots. and that I really was inappropriately dressed for the event, and I was trying to draw attention to myself, and I had, I mean, it was crazy to me, because I left the house feeling really good and feeling confident, and I came back crying, and I didn't know what I had done wrong. And that continued on with me, and I see it happening. I see women judging other women for the way that they're dressed or the way that they look, or men not necessarily respecting or treating women equally, even when they have the same job titles. I remember at one of my jobs, I had a male direct report, and they were paying him $7,000 more than what I was making, and he was reporting to me. So I brought that up, and of course, that became like a huge, you know, a huge PR, not PR debacle, but I would say it was like they wanted to squash that really quickly, you know, because they wanted to move on, and they quickly gave me a raise and they fixed it. And, but it was like, why was that happening anyways? So I can't imagine, like, I've always been very vocal about these issues, and I've always gone through the proper channels, and I've reported it, and I've been outspoken. What's happening to women who aren't, you know, what are women who are not willing to stand up and say things? What are they going through? Because a lot of women who I talk to who are also experiencing the same treatment would look at me and say, I just want to keep my job. I just want to keep my job. I don't want to get fired. So I think there's a lot more of this that happens that we know of, because I think a lot of women stay silent.
You know, in this day and age too, it still baffles me that both men and women in the workforce today will say things to other women that they would never ever say to men. And why that's still accepted in many, many places.
Well, and think about, too, the social media aspect now that we deal with. And this is a world that I live in. So I think there's a lot of pros and there's a lot of good that can come out of social media. But I also am very aware of the negatives. And part of one of the experiences that I had was someone had started a Facebook page about me, and they were posting pictures from my social media accounts talking about how unprofessional I was, like pictures of me in Halloween costumes and saying how unprofessional I was and I should be fired. And so that has allowed, it's really empowered people to sit behind a keyboard and attack others and not have the face-to-face banter, and not to be confident enough to go up to someone and say, hey, I noticed this might be a concern, or I want to have a conversation with you about this real topic. And it's not that anymore. It's just get behind a keyboard and fire something off, because you don't have to deal with the ramifications of it.
Sure. The cowardly way of doing it. The fact is they don't have to know who you are. And I do find, you know, even in television, finding that, you know, we all get critiqued, you know, for our looks and everything else, but even more so for women over what they would wear or the makeup they would wear. And right. And I would look at it and go, good God, what are you watching? You know, are you watching for the news, right, or how everybody looks?
Right. And I think there's a huge amount of pressure on women to look really put together and to wear certain clothes and to make sure their makeup is good. But then once you cross over, you know, even you dip your toe in the other line, it's like, well, she's too sexy. She's trying too hard. You know, what is she trying to do? Get viewers to, you know, think she's a sex symbol. Like it's, you can't win. And I've watched reporter friends deal with this, just the hate mail. And it's the same thing. It's, well, you're too fat to be on air, or you don't ever look right, or it's that dress was too tight. And it's like, just let people live, you know, like let people exist, and we're all doing the best that we can. And why are women held to this different standard? And I think it's a sign of, you know, obviously things have improved over the years and over the decades, but we're not there yet. We're not where we need to be yet, in my opinion.
I think you hit the nail on the head too. It's like, you can't win.
Yeah.
No matter what.
You really can't. It's frustrating for sure.
Let's talk about the businesses that you deal with. So let's talk about some of the companies and businesses that you're dealing with, and especially the ones run by women, the challenges that they face in this day and age, because, you know, I hate to say it, but for the most part, it's still a man's world in many aspects of it, isn't it?
It is. And I think, you know, we are so lucky to work with such a diverse group of businesses. You know, we have everything from salons and spas to fitness and food to insurance companies to financial investment firms. It's a broad range, and you see it in some areas more than others. We worked with a female run insurance company, and she was the president was a woman, and I just watched her have to deal with such an extra level of nonsense because she was a woman in a predominantly male field. And it's, so you have to think about it from that aspect. It's like, here we are, we're running our businesses, we're entrepreneurs, but also we're women. And we also have to deal with all of these other things. And so that's what we see a lot. And we really work hard to try to encourage women to feel confident who they are and who they are, and to be proud of who they are digitally, because everything's digital now. So everybody's looking to their social, looking on their website, and just be unapologetically you, because that's really, that's what people are looking for. They're looking for that authentic, real person. And I think that's the way to sort of mold your business and brand it in a way that people are going to be drawn to it and attracted to it. And they're going to want to employ you and hire you for whatever it is you do.
I guess that sounds like the bottom line on anything, whether you're a man or a woman, that people are going to deal with you because of you.
Yeah, we do a lot of personal branding activities with a lot of our clients, even women who, and men too, even people who are, whether they're starting a new career or they're sort of figuring out like, what is my niche going to be? What is it that who do I want to target? What's sort of going to be my shtick? Because we know that with good marketing, it's best to have like a thing, you know, like a niche. You know, you can come out and say, okay, you're a marketing firm. But when you come out and say you're a marketing firm that focuses on women and all of our branding is really fun and vibrant, that's going to sell better to people. So even though we're focused on women, you know, it's, people still love it because it's very clear what we do. So we work with a lot of people on that personal branding, figuring out what are your unique sales propositions, what makes you different from your competitor, and why would someone want to hire you? And the people who do the best are vulnerable, they're authentic, it's clear they have a passion for what they do. Those are the brands that we see rising to the top.
And I'm guessing too that this whole COVID-19 pandemic has added a whole new element to what you do, and the uncertainty of it now too.
Yeah, it's, you know, there's been pros and cons. It's been a bumpy roller coaster since this all started. We had a lot of clients initially kind of pull back and say, I got to cut costs. Like, I can't afford this. I don't know what the future holds. I don't know what the next few months are going to look like. Some closed up. But then we had a lot of people come out of the woodwork and say, wow, I'm realizing the importance of having a website now and a good website, or I'm realizing I really should have been on social media this entire time. And we did a lot of educational webinars. We partnered with a lot of the chambers and some other organizations that were focused on different industries. And we talked about the importance of digital presence because that has been hit home. And as much as I don't love always being on the computer and love always being on my phone, I try to set some boundaries around that, but it's here to stay. And I think that if you're going to run a successful business, you at least need to look buttoned up and clean online. And that's a lot of what we've been doing these last few months, is helping people get to the point where they feel really proud of their online presence so they can share it with prospective customers.
I guess if that is really the one thing that COVID-19 has brought about, is I think a lot of companies and businesses have had an online presence, but not to where it should be. And in a very short period of time, I guess 2 to 3 weeks back in March, all of a sudden that's where everybody was.
Yeah. And I have to say, this is not a jab because I love my restaurant folks, but restaurants are one of the biggest culprits of not having good websites and not having their menu available and not updating their websites regularly. And that's because that's a tough industry to live in, and you're working nonstop and you're working nights and weekends. So I get it. But I think that became very clear right at the beginning when people were trying to figure out who was open for takeout and who they could support. And there was no real way to get that information because restaurants weren't keeping that up to date. So it became evident really quickly that you have to have somebody who's at least somewhat skilled in making those quick updates or posting on social regularly, because it was the only way we could communicate for a while, you know?
And that's, you know, I'm guilty as charged with something like that, where you go to, you look for a restaurant that you know, and you don't find them. They have an online presence. So you go to the next one that does.
Absolutely. Yep. There's a lot of business lost there for sure.
You think a lot of that in this day and age too, was a lot of these, you know, small businesses just really, they probably knew they needed something, but just didn't think it was important at the time.
Well, and it's a matter of time and resources. So that's the other thing that we try to work with our small business owners on, because a lot of these people are, it's one person in charge, it's the owner. Or, you know, they have a small team and resources are limited, time is limited. And so they're just focused on providing the service or the product, and they're not really focused on the marketing aspect of things. So we see a lot of people come through the door who just really don't have the capacity to do this work. And so we have to step in and do it for them. And I think this is one of the biggest, you know, I always say to people, if you want to start a business, that's great. You need to earmark money right away for marketing. You know, it's not a, if you build it, they will come type thing anymore. You have to tell people to come. So you have to do that through strategic marketing. And a lot of it is online.
I think one of the things too, at least I've found this through my experience through the years, usually when money gets tight or the economy takes a drop, the first thing to go is your marketing, because that's the easiest thing to get rid of. But it really should be the last thing you even think about getting rid of.
That's, yeah, and that has been such a challenge, sort of educating people on that. And thank you for bringing that up and saying that, because that's how people are going to know you're there. That is how people are going to get updated on what it is that you're doing and how you're being impacted by the pandemic. And so the minute that money sort of goes away, you're left with just finger crossing, right? So you're hoping people will know to come to you, that you're hoping people will know what you have to offer. So I always say to people, if you got to cut the marketing budget, don't cut it entirely. Try to cut it down. You know, look at your budget across the board and see where you can cut from every pocket, but try to leave some dollars for marketing, because it is that important.
Well, at least with social media too, is it, once you've got something established, it's not like radio and television and newspaper where you're always going to have these costs. And yes, you'll have maintenance costs and everything else, but your initial costs are really in the setup of all this. And once that's there, you know, now it's just, you know, keeping ahead of the game.
Yeah. And that is why I love social media, because you can do it yourself, right? I mean, if you sit down once a week for an hour and schedule out your Facebook posts or figure out what you're going to put on whatever platform it is you're on, it can be done itself. So you're absolutely right. If you get the business started, you invest in a good website, you get someone to clean up your social media so it just looks really well branded, then it becomes an automated system and you can bring on an intern to help you do it. You can do it in-house. Like, there's so many different ways, but ignoring it and not doing it is really not an option anymore, because we have all of your competitors are going to be doing it. So if you're not doing it, they're going to get the business. Just like you said, with the whole restaurant, whoever's online and I can find their menu, that's who's going to get my business.
Now, in your time running Chikmedia, my guess is the biggest change has been social media, where, you know, we don't talk about traditional advertising anymore. It's like you advertise where you're going to reach people.
Yeah. And, you know, so I'm still a big fan of traditional advertising. I like a blend. I'm a sort of holistic, comprehensive approach marketer. So if someone comes to me and they, you know, they target a demographic that it makes sense for, like we work with an audiologist whose demographic is a senior population. So primarily people 50 plus are the ones that they want coming in to get their hearing checked and doing baselines. And so we did a lot of print with them. We did some traditional media. We did some TV because it made perfect sense. And so I think it's really about, and I teach social media marketing at Springfield College. And one of the first weeks in class, we talk about the need for traditional marketing and what that means and how it fits into a larger marketing strategy. So if a client has a budget and they can afford to do it, I like to do a blend if it makes sense for the audience they're trying to reach.
Sure. Makes sense. And I'm sure, actually, when you talk about teaching, a lot of young women must look to you and say, well, look at what I've done. And the fact is that you can do this too, if you work hard at it. This didn't come to you overnight.
No, it didn't. It certainly didn't. And I always, yes, thank you for saying that. I talk to students and my nieces and, you know, just sort of young people in general. I employ a lot of recent graduates part-time helping us do work. And I tell them my journey, you know, like I had to get a job right out of college. I mean, I took a couple months off, but then I got right into it because I had college loans. And then it took me 8 years to put myself through grad school because I had to do it while I was working because I couldn't afford to not work. So I had to take one class at a time. I always have in my entire life, I don't remember there being a time where I haven't worked two jobs. So I've always had a side gig, and even now my side gig is teaching. So I run Chikmedia and then I teach at two universities. So I always have that. And I think part of it is I don't know if it's like survival instinct, but it's always like in my head, if something goes wrong here, I have a plan B. And they say, and I've heard people say, well, you shouldn't have a plan B because you want to throw everything into your plan A to make it really successful. For me, it's like, I love teaching as much as I love running the company. So I'm happy to do both, but I just always like to have a backup plan because you never know. You never know what could happen. And here we are in a pandemic. And if I had lost all my clients, at least I could have still taught. You know what I mean?
And I also think there's a benefit to that too. I taught up at UMass for 14 years that the benefit that these students have to have someone who's teaching them, who's in the business every day and sees exactly what's going on, as opposed to someone who, well, they learned this in school and now they're teaching. It's like you're in the trenches every day.
It's funny you say that because that is one of the, I'd say, top feedbacks that I get when the students do their, they have to fill out a survey at the end of every year. And one of the most common things that is said is this teacher knows what she's talking about because she's in this world every single day. So I do think, you know, there's nothing against career professors, but I think even career professors who have side gigs teach better because they just know what's happening. They're living it every single day. And if I had learned social media 10 years ago and was teaching it, I'd be completely out of touch. You know, I have to live, eat, sleep, and breathe it every day in order to be able to effectively teach it. My syllabus changes every year. There's no automation with this class.
No, never. But I think that's the benefit for them. They're very lucky. I when I was teaching at UMass, Congressman Neal, who I think he still teaches up there.
Yeah.
And I would say to these students, kids would walk in late to his class. And I would say to them, I said, do you understand who you have for a professor? How lucky you are to have a sitting congressman as a professor. And right. It's like, I mean, they didn't have that when I was in school.
I know. It's incredible the access to people, especially, I mean, UMass is such a good school and they've got all sorts of incredible teachers up there and professors. I think that's one thing that, and I think back to my college career, and I remember Ann Coulter coming to, she was debating one of our political science teachers, professors, and I remember being there and like, you know, thinking this is interesting, this is really cool, and now I'm like, I mean, I don't agree with anything the woman has to say, but I appreciate that. I was sitting 5 feet from her and she was debating one of my professors who I loved and adored. So like those types of experiences are, I mean, they're just, it's amazing what some colleges do for their students.
Meg, what advice would you give to a young woman who's thinking about starting up their own business or just getting into business right out of college, to really make the move forward, not be discouraged?
I think that, you know, when my first job, I always say Six Flags is my first real job because my first job was an administrative assistant. So I had spent $100,000 on college and then I went out and got a job as an administrative assistant. And people will look at me, you know, college students, when I go out, I go back and speak at Roger Williams all the time. And they'll kind of look at me like, what did you do? I'm like, I took a job because it was getting my foot in the door. And before I knew it, they gave me marketing tasks and they changed my title. And then that's why I was able to get hired at Six Flags, because I was able to put marketing on my resume. And so I think I say to young women, be ready to sort of work really hard. Like there's going to be some elbow grease in what you do in order to make it to a point where you're happy and comfortable, and you don't have to be miserable, but just be prepared to deal with challenging personalities and to get your hands dirty and sort of look at it from like a long-term perspective. Because for me, there was a lot of bumps along the road. And I think everything that I've experienced has led me to be really comfortable and confident in talking to people and have effective communication skills. And all of that's important. I think that for young people who are looking to sort of graduate and start businesses, I think that's really even more challenging than someone starting a business who's been in the field for many years. There's a lot I didn't realize about what entrepreneurship was, and that's the emotions of it. You know, it's very high ups and very low downs, especially in my world, because we have clients. It's not like we have clients who at any point can say, I'm giving you my 30-day notice, like we don't want to work with you anymore. And then it's like, okay, I have to adjust budgets every, you know, constantly. Sure. So be prepared. Hire people who are good at what you're not good at. I have an accountant for a reason, because I don't touch numbers. I have a graphic designer for a reason, because I don't, my brain doesn't work that way. So you have to acknowledge what you're not good at and find the right help and be willing to invest back in the company in order for it to be successful.
You hit on something too. You talk long-term. I think in this day and age, so many are thinking short-term. This is the long race. This is the marathon, not the sprint.
Yeah. And I, if you had asked me 10, 15 years ago, when I first got onto the work, well, it was 15 years ago, I'm not going to pretend I'm younger than I am. If you had asked me if I was going to own a business, I would have told you no. Up until probably 8 to 12 months before I officially went full-time with Chikmedia, people would ask me, well, what's your goal with that? And I'd say, I don't want to be a business owner. I don't want anything to do with that. Like, I don't want to deal with that, because I had always had it sort of on the side, and even on the side, it was difficult to manage. So I was like, there's no way I'm ever going to do this full time. And I eventually, so like my long-term goal was never that. It was always to be like director of communications at a big company or to teach or something like that. But life sent me down a very different path, and it became very clear in dealing with a lot of, you know, issues and situations that I really needed to be my own boss. And I wanted to build a life for myself where I could work remotely. I'm working from Cape Cod right now, and I can work from anywhere, and my staff is all remote, and I'm a leader, and I get to make the decisions, and I get to, you know, cultivate and work with so many different clients. It's never boring. It's never boring from day to day. And that was the life I wanted to build for myself. And I realized that the way to do that was going to be through starting the business. So here I am.
And you have control over it. That's the nice part. Let's talk about, and, you know, when you talk about the challenges that you faced a challenge early on in your life when you were a teenager. You are a cancer survivor.
Yes. Yes. So I was diagnosed with melanoma. I had just turned 20. So I actually had them all removed when I was 19. And 2 weeks later, right after my birthday, I think it was either the day of or the day after my birthday, I was diagnosed with stage 2 melanoma, which is the deadliest form of skin cancer. So I was a big tanning bed user back in my high school career. This is another reason why I like the women supporting women thing is so important to me. I just had terrible self-confidence when I was in high school. My hair is kind of blonde now, but it was red when I was in high school. I was like very fair, red hair, and I just hated it. I hated everything about my appearance. I didn't look like my friends, and that bothered me. And so I started using tanning beds, and the next thing I knew, I was, you know, sophomore year of college, and I remember always itching like a spot on my stomach. And I finally was like, okay, it's kind of weird. So I brought it to my doctor's attention, and she looked at it and said, I think it looks fine. It was a little mole. And I said, well, I was 19 in the doctor's office. And I said, well, I don't feel right about it. So I'm not going to leave your office until you write me the referral, because she actually argued with me about it. And she finally agreed. She said, fine, if you want to go and give yourself a scar, you go right ahead. And I was at a stage 2 melanoma. I got diagnosed 2 weeks later when I went back to have the stitches removed. So it was a crazy experience, because at such a young age, it was weird that I was like, I had like a moment of like, no, I'm going to take charge here. You're going to write me the referral. And I don't know if anyone, if every 19-year-old would have done the same thing.
I don't think so. At that point in time doing that, and I think most of us tend to go, oh, well, okay, if you say it's all right, it's all right. But
that's what we want to hear at the doctors, right? Oh, sure. No, you're fine. That's what we want to hear.
I mean, the fact that you didn't accept that, what was that at 20? I mean, you know, the middle of your college life and everything else, it had to hit you hard.
Yeah, it was really hard. I think there were so many different layers of it. I think first and foremost, when people hear skin cancer, they don't think it's very serious. And so I actually had a couple professors, and actually my boss at the time, I was working at one of the cafes, like the little coffee shop on campus. Even she was like, come on, you can get back to work. I mean, I had drainage tubes. I had 75 stitches. I had lymph nodes extracted from under each arm. This was not, you know, the removal of a melanoma surgery. I was put under. The surgery took 3 hours. So this was very different. This was like a more serious. This is what skin cancer can become. It's what it can lead to. And so I dealt with a lot of professors not really understanding why I was sort of milking it. But I couldn't walk like long distances because there were so many stitches in my abdomen. And then I also had to deal with my friends. And I remember I remember we were all going to go to the beach one day, and I said, well, I have to get an umbrella. You know, I can't go to the beach unless I get an umbrella. This was months after I had healed. And they were all like, okay, yeah, we'll pitch in. And we got to the store, and one of them said, you know what? I'm not pitching, and I'm not going to use the umbrella. And I lost it. I turned around, I went home, I cried. It was like there was no sort of acknowledgement of like you had gone through something serious and now you were trying to protect yourself. Like, I just don't think people got it. So, you know, couple that with like, now I had all these disfiguring scars. So I already had self-esteem issues. Now I had this really gnarly scar on my stomach that I didn't want anyone to see. And everybody's going on spring break in bikinis. And it was like a whole perfect storm of just a lot of things hitting me at the age of 20 that I was not prepared to handle.
Yeah, I don't think anybody at any age is prepared to handle it, never mind at 20. But right. You've taken your experience and you're helping others, skin cancer awareness. I know that's part of your mission.
It is, yeah. I spent years and years, and I'm still, of course, the pandemic has changed things now, but I had three speeches booked on behalf of Impact Melanoma. They are still a client of mine. Those have all been canceled because the conferences have been canceled, but I'm still to this day speaking out about this topic. And, you know, after I recovered, I was going to school for journalism and I was working at a newspaper, like a little magazine newspaper. And they said, we want to do a summer edition. And I said, well, hey, I've had skin cancer. Do you want me to do something on that? And they lost it. They were like, do something on that. You're going to be the front page cover. So I wrote this first person story and I appeared on the cover of the magazine and I actually showed my scar. And that sort of was the catalyst to becoming a national spokesperson. So I got picked up by the American Academy of Dermatology. They sent me to Colorado for this big public service photo shoot. I was doing media interviews in New York City for like ABC World News and CNN and all these Associated Press. And then I actually ended up receiving an award from Cosmopolitan Magazine because of all the work that I had done in PR around skin cancer. So I definitely turned it into a career. For a while, I was a PR and marketing manager at Impact for years. And so it's just, it's been something that I think happened for a reason. I've had a lot of people come up to me and say, your speech saved my life. And I think that's a big part of what I was put here to do.
And that's, you know, especially at that early age. And I think part of the impact that you have in so many different ways is the fact that you are young and it happened to you at a young age. And I think, you know, at 20, you think you're invincible and you were proof that no, you're not. Things can happen. You also think about it. These are things that happen to other people.
Right. And that's a big thing that I actually always talk about when I'm out speaking is I was 17, 18, 19 years old when I was engaging in this behavior that I knew probably wasn't good for me. But in my head, I thought, well, if I'm going to deal with this ramifications, it's going to be down the line, like when I'm older. And no, it was 2.5 years later when I, you know, after I started sort of not wearing sunscreen and not paying attention to my skin, that I was put in this predicament. And so I think it was a big reality check, but also it has made me realize what to stress over and what not to, and the type of life that I want to live. It's probably one of the reasons why I'm an entrepreneur, because I just dealt with so much reporting to other people that I was like, I don't want to do this. I don't want to be stressed out. I don't want to have my mental health suffer. I don't want, which of course always manifests into physical health. And my life is too short for that. And I could get melanoma again at any time. So I'm going to be happy with what I do every single day, because it's just, life's too short. So it definitely had an everlasting impact on me in many different ways.
Yeah, cancer is a great equalizer for all of us, any one of us who've suffered from it. It's that it does put things in perspective for you, but it puts yours in perspective at a very, very young age.
It really does. I'm grateful for that, as much as it was a terrible experience and there's, you know, still emotions around it. I am grateful that I was able to catch it early, that I was able to survive it, and that I was able to turn it into advocacy works to hopefully impact and protect other people.
Well, the other part too is that at 20, you know, when having fun and going to school and everything else, it just puts, everything comes to a stop.
It sure did. Yeah, it was not the carefree, fun sophomore year that I was hoping it was going to be. You know, it took months to heal. Of course, if I had that surgery now, it would take like a year to heal. It's amazing how much your body does not like to heal after 30. I say it's downhill from 30.
Just wait.
I know, that's what everybody says. They're like, just you wait. So, you know, I had put my life on hold. I went back to school pretty quickly because I wanted to. You know, my parents had told me to take the semester off, but I was like, no, I'm going to go back and try to, you know, get back into a normal routine. And it was hard. And, it just wasn't a fun year. It wasn't enjoyable. It wasn't until my senior year that I sort of got back into the groove of things and took back my confidence and sure. my focus on my career and graduating and all of that.
And you think about sun safety too. I mean, for years I worked at a golf course and I can remember going out watering greens and being out there without a shirt and not putting any sunscreen on. I think back in my day, it was zinc oxide that you'd put on your nose. The fact that in so many ways, it seems like we haven't come far enough as far as skin safety and the precautions that we need to take. And it has to start at an early age.
It really does. And I think that's one of the biggest issues. So we know that melanoma is the second most common form of cancer for young people ages 15 to 29. So this is a cancer that's affecting a younger demographic. And it's because of the misuse of tanning beds and the use of tanning beds. There's no proper way to use a tanning bed, but and the lack of sunscreen and the lack of awareness. And when you sunburn a body that's under the age of 18, you're causing lifelong damage. You know, I mean, you're causing lifelong damage sunburn at any age, but particularly before those, like in those developmental years. So this should be a part of the health curriculum, and it should be hit home that this is a disease that can affect you right around the corner, right in high school, right in college. I mean, it can affect any age, of course, but I think we have a long way to go. And I think a lot of it has to do with because it's behavioral, you know, like, we like, especially here in New England, we like to be outside. We like to be at the beach. We like to have a tan because Coco Chanel told us we needed to have a tan many years ago when she invented the bikini. So that is, it's behavioral. Like breast cancer, there's not really much we can do to prevent it. We could just be diligent about it. Or, you know, prostate cancer or colon cancer, we know to get our screenings. We know to be careful about things. But with skin cancer, nobody's telling you to go get a skin check. You have to sort of do that on your own. And it's sort of anti-fun to be in the shade and to put on something. It's a, and so I just think that we're not making a part of the regular, okay, I've scheduled my doctor's appointment, I've scheduled my teeth cleaning, I got to go get a skin check too. And that's always what I recommend to people. Go out and have fun and do your thing. Just make sure you're seeing a dermatologist once a year.
My thanks to Meghan Rothschild for being my guest this week on the Even Better Western Mass podcast, and my thanks to you for watching or listening to this week's edition. I'm Dave Mattson. Stay well, and if you can, join us next week.